Heute bei Global Art Fair darf ich den belgischen Maler, Regisseur und Choreografen Jan Fabre begrüßen. Heuer ist er in der Performance I Am A Mistake im Zusammenhang mit dem Impulstanz auf der Bühne zu sehen. Gleichzeitig bietet das Leopold Museum eine Reise ins Gedächtnis des Künstlers anhand von Zeichnungen, Fotografien, Skulpturen sowie filmischen Darstellungen der Performances des Künstlers von der zweiten Hälfte der 1970er Jahren bis heute, welche unter dem Titel Stigmata zu sehen ist.
No, I come since to Vienna already since the beginning of the 80s. I presented my work in the 80s already in the Wiener Festwoche. Then from the 90s. I also worked together with Carol Ainsburg of the Dance Impulse. I worked already 20 years together with Mario Moroner Gallery in Vienna and in Salzburg. I did a couple of years ago a big show in the Kunsthistorische Museum. So I know Vienna a little bit. The title Stigmata is chosen by the curator, by Germano Celans. He's a really great curator. He's the inventor, essentially, of Arte Povera. And he knows me since the beginning of the 80s. And for example, here, the brown spot on my nose. It's from crawling in the rail on my hands and knees for 4 hours long in Antwerp, and my nose was completely destroyed. And I still have these on my nose, these brown spots. So I have a lot of injuries in scarves on my body from all these performances and actions that I did. So the idea of stigmata is referring to that also. It's a spiritual aspect. The sacrifice as an artist with your body for art. Yeah, it's something deep spiritual, almost religious, because I believe strongly in beauty, the force and the power and the vulnerability of beauty. That's my profession, to defend this. I was raised in a family, my mother was rich, bourgeois, Catholic, my father poor, communist. I was baptized, but the papa didn't like the church, so we could not go to the church. But the mama in the evening was always talking about Christ in the Bible, so it really impregnated me. And I started rediscovering the church because I was working with two Polish composers together, Henri Milek-Gorecki, was in the years 86, 87, and another Polish composer in Katowice, Eugeniusz Knapik. I worked with him on an opera trilogy. And by visiting Gorecki and Knapik, for example, these composers, they took me in the 80s, before Solidaridesk, to the church, because in the church, a lot of intellectuals, philosophers, thinkers, artists, they met. And it was the church was a kind of spiritual, intellectual place where composers, artists, writers met. And I started, let's say, re-respecting the church for that reason, because in Poland it was really a sovereign place for intellectuals and artists. And then, of course, I went a lot to churches to discover the great art pieces in churches. Till today I go see all this great art. I think I'm an atheist thanks to God. And how I define beauty. For me, beauty is a consilience between ethical values and aesthetical principles. Because when it would be only aesthetics, we were talking about makeup. Yeah, because when you talk about ethical values and aesthetical principles, this consilience together, then you talk I mean, I think my art is always about, as a political dimension, a social dimension, a philosophical dimension, a religious dimension. The exhibition is made 3-4 years ago in Rome for the Maxi Museum. And it was an idea from Germano Celans to use the tables. Because it's a work from 78 that originally I made on these tables, instruments to break in and to fight. And as a young artist, in when I was 19, 20, I was breaking in rich neighborhoods outside of Antwerp. But I never stole something. I filmed everything, but I never stole something. But I was breaking in also in photographic jobs, art shops, to steal paper, to steal photographic material. And these I also filmed and photographed. So these four tables, they are from the permanent collection of the Museum of Contemporary Art. And these four tables, they became, to say, the matrix for that exhibition. And it's a little bit of table as a kind of platform. The platform for the object, for the drawing, but also the platform for the performance. Yeah. And these tables were my working table at home also. Now I was quite influenced as a young artist by Jean-Henri Fabre. He's a French entomologist, and I got an heritage at home from origin manuscript drawings, because he was a fantastic drawer, and he wrote prose about insects by observing insects in nature. He wrote the 12 books, the standard works of entomology. And this inspired me a lot. Scientists always inspired me as a young artist. Still today, I'm always looking over the wall from science, because in science there's a lot of good scientists. They do the leap in the unknown. They create new hypotheses. And sometimes are more, let's say, the scientists sometimes are more daring than artists. So I'm more influenced by scientists than by art. I think since the exhibition starts with performance from 76 until now, it's more than 40 years since, what for me the exhibition reveals is the type of artist I am. I'm not a great intellectual. I drive on instinct, intuition and intelligence. And these three things, it's the connecting of the brain, the heart and the balls. And I'm a type of artist who have to do things out of experience, feel them physically, because then I can think better. So I'm not a conceptual artist. I have to really do the things to feel and to, it's, you could say, even say through the process of pain I learned. It takes a lifetime to become a young artist. And second of all, there are some performances I did in the 70s and 80s, probably I could not do anymore today. For example, the performance with Fred Astaire with the cats, with the cats flying around me. We redid it for a movie, and people were angry for this. Even when nothing was wrong with the cats, in that sense, the world has changed. Huh? A lot of things, people, we're living a much more conservative time on these moments, much more regression time, regression. Regression conservative, you see, this is also what's happening in Europe, in the political level, than 20 years, 30 years ago. But at the same time, it's dangerous, because you become too quickly too political correct, you understand? And as an artist, you have to stay sovereign. You have to stay away from this, almost this daily reality also, I think, because sometimes great art has to surpass reality. It doesn't have to be immediately a reflection of reality. Because when it's a reflection of reality, it becomes fashion. And you know, fashion is news from today, and tomorrow is old. So I think my work, my visual arts, it surpasses this, it goes another way, another direction. You could say that Belgium art in Flemish art, because I'm coming from a very small country. And we were always occupied by the French, the Germans, the Spanish, the Dutch. And you see this in history, in the art history, you see this, that all these great painters, essentially they were very subversive in their work, very ironical. They were attacking on a very playful, with a smile on the face, very, let us say, a resistance against the power who was suppressing, to say, the country. And I think that's a deep root in Belgium art, in Flemish art, the irony in the subversivity. I think that's what you do as an artist. There, you always look for truthfulness on the moment itself, particularly as a solo performer. When you do a performance, you want to be as truthful as possible to yourself. And that's what you also, when I work in my company with actors and dancers, that's what you're also training for, to be, yeah, to be truthful, to stay very close to yourself, physically and mentally. It's, I mean, for example, on Belgium Rules, my new creation, I will do the world premiere for the festival. I worked with my company for 5 months, with 15 actors and dancers. And essentially, we never talk about the public. We talk about content. Why we do this? Why do we make this work? For which reason? What is it? Because what I did, essentially, Belgium Rules is a kind of critical love declaration to my country. And one of the reasons I probably wanted to make it already years ago is because I'm living in a country where, for example, the Flemish side of Belgium, where I was born in Antwerp, they became very nationalistic. Extreme right is winning a lot. Essentially, they want to split up the country. What I'm not completely agreeing with is because I have no sympathy for extreme right. So to make already a production about Belgium, even a critical love declaration, is almost a political choice. It's saying publicly that I like the idea of a king and queen, and I like the idea of my country. Because a lot of my mise-en-scenes are based on the lines of strategy. And it's not, I mean, when you think historically about, I think for me, it's also my visual arts, it's also a movie. In an exhibition, I think the brain is the most sexy part of the body. Because when there's no imagination, there's no erection. And it's also for a woman, erection in a mental sense. So the brain is it's a very important organ. I think in my stage work, and also my visual arts, in my writings, I researched the subject and the object was always the human body. I also in the exhibition you see this in Stigmata. There is research about the blood of the human body, about the sperm, the water inside the body, the skeleton, the skin, the organs, and also the brain. And all these topics I also researched in my theatre work and in my writings. There's a kind of guiding line that I developed over the 40 years, what I call physiological acting. It's through a series of exercises that the performers in my company learn to know that emotions are something not from the outside, but it's all physiological processes inside. They learn to understand what their kidneys are doing, the liver, the heart, the blood. So it's that training I give my performers. I think in the creation, what I presented in Belgium Rules, I think one of the most important topics is the not accepting from the others. Look what's happening in Europe. I just heard now also today that Austria is closing their borders for refugees. I think it's a scandal. When you're a country from the middle of Europe, on a humanistic level, I think you have to open your borders and help people. We Europeans, so it's probably 650 million people. Why we cannot help 1 million people? And people have a short memory, eh? Hungary is also closing their borders. In 1958, when the Russians came to them, more than 700,000 Hungarians came to Belgium, Netherlands, and France, and we all accepted them. That all these people who vote for these populistic right movements, they forget one thing, that we have 70 years of peace in Europe. The moment tomorrow will destroy Europe, there will be existing a vacuum, and we will go again against war. And these people, we have to defend peace after 70 years. It's historically immense long for Europe. But all these extreme populistic organizations against Europe, it's essentially being against peace.